playing team fighters into him and still finding success.
Yeah.
And there's no way, in my opinion, that SKT makes the same type of blunder at the start of Game 3 that they did in Game 2. So Koo Tigers really has to step up their game if they want to take one.
And now you have a problem for if you're the Koo Tigers. We expect Rek'Sai to come in for SKT like they did in Game 1. The thing for Koo Tigers is, I don't think they really want the Lulu pick. Because we've seen Faker can play like Kassadin into it, and Kuro didn't really do a whole lot. They might be forced to take it anyway, just because it's open. But they would most likely prefer to go something like Shen and Fiora, and try and do what they did in Game 2, have that setup at least, but this time around execute it better. You just had like 10-15 minutes to talk about what went wrong, why didn't we win the game. So far, 1-for-1 at least with that one, because Fiora has been instant locked. Koo Tigers needs to find a way to go back to what worked for them when it comes to Smet being a split pusher. And you just have to try and make less mistakes. I know it sounds easy, but...
Yep. Yep. And they're not going to go with Lulu. I think they want Kuro and Victor. I honestly think Koo Tigers just want all of their individual best champions. Smet, Fiora, Kuro, Victor. Hojin already on Lee Sin. His name used to be Lee. Get Shen now for the support before SKT can lock in Rek'Sai and Shen. And Ashe has been their most successful AD carry.
I like the idea of Ashe for them. Said before, they bring out the Zac, they bring out the Ashe. You have to play differently around that. It's something that absolutely caught Fnatic off guard when they played just Ashe arrow down the mid lane in the engage, but that's Kassadin as well.
So, Koo Tigers are saying, you can play Kassadin into our Lulu. We will now try and do exactly the same. Only difference is there is no
a lot of differences.
Yeah, it's a lot of, obviously, player-wise, fake of Kuro, but... There's also no hot or no great wave play AD carry. Ashe takes a little bit more time taking down these waves compared to Sivir, which was one of the reasons it could work for SKT, because they could move Sivir to mid lane and have Kassadin in the side lane.
Exactly. As well as having the wave clear, SKT also had Rumble in the top lane, so they had a big AoE team fighting presence if the Kassadin was away farming. Koo has two melee mid laners and not much wave clear as an AD carry. SKT, even though you normally don't think of Sivir going with Lulu, you actually put the Sivir with the Lulu here because it's something SKT has done very well in the past. They have incredible wave clear, great team fighting, and a high early power spiking team. This is exactly what SKT should do.
You know what feels good? When you can play the same champion three times in a row. He's already feeling good on it. He's been making great equalizers. He's going to do it again this game.
And again, it's just been this pick that's not going to win the 1v1 against the Fiora, but it's going to sit back at its own tower. And if you ever want to tower dive it, the hourglass, the amount of damage you can put down with your AoE abilities is enough to at least buy time for SKT to make a play elsewhere. Wow. But Koo Tigers is going full pick composition right here. We are going to look to catch off targets with Ashe Arrow. We're going to have to hook from a Thresh, Lee Sin, single them out and one-shot them.
And they have to play it so perfectly because they are at such an immense disadvantage as far as wave clearing is concerned in this game. Like, this is 100% a pick composition, but the question will be whether or not their turrets are collapsing around them as they're trying to get fights, because every time they commit to a kill, three or four people, where is SKT gonna go? And that will be the story of this game.
Sivir once again for Bang, telling you SKT is going to be throwing that on constantly. We see Faker pushing the mid lane as well with Lulu trying to keep Kuro down. It was vice versa last time. Let's see what he can make happen as they get out of champion select in the next 10 seconds. It looks like Ignite for the mid laners again.
Yeah.
I'm absolutely loving the fact that they've switched away from the TP action there in the mid lane.
Basically looking to be stronger when we have these fights going on instead of having the global pressure. Even though I still like it on a Kassadin to have that teleport, especially now when it's so hard to execute your composition. Like, credit to Koo Tigers for saying, we just lost two games in a row. We don't care. We will pick a comp that is so hard to play, and we trust in our ability to pull it off, and then try and get a comeback going.
Sometimes you got to test yourself to really find that inner skill. And hopefully they can bring it out here in Game 3. The teams are about to hit the rift for Game 3, so update your series predictions. Hashtag SKT win or hashtag KOO win. We'll update the fan vote once we are into game. We're very close to that Summoner's Cup for SKT. Koo now trying to hang on to their World Championship hopes. They've made it all the way here in their first year as a team, really scrapping things together and hopefully bringing out their first victory in the World Finals here.
And even though there are holes or weaknesses within this team composition for Koo that can be exploited, I still love the fact that they have picked these specific champions for this composition. Koo Tigers, when they made their recovery, out of having a poor summer split. It mm-hmm. was a lot of Ashe and it was a lot of pick compositions. They are playing champions that they are comfortable on. And that is so important because we're worried about them tilting off the face of the earth when SKT turns around that game too. So how do you get your comfort back? It is in the champion picks, and Ku is just going to try to outplay the crap out of SKT in this game.
Looks like things are going to be very calm to start this one off. Definitely SKT's game to lose off the bat. Full control of the early game would pretty much solidify the win here, as Ku, in their attempts to do Baron last game, and their attempts to kind of pressure the turret, they aren't really trial and erroring. They're not seeing how SKT is acting, so it's flying. Every time they go in, they have errors left and right, or they split.
I
want to
see SKT lane swap, though, in this game here, because I think Ku Tigers have some very, very strong lane setups. Ashe is a fantastic laner, and she has a range support and Thresh next to her against an Alistar, so that's very good for Ku Tigers. Fiora into Rumble, give her that one-on-one lane from the start as well. That's what we see from SKT now. They're like, okay, we're staying on bottom side in case they were invading. We were showing we were down here. Maybe we would trick them into thinking we were going to be on the bottom side. Yep. Now they swap it up top lane here. So they do get the lane swap for SKT. I think that's very important for this early game. But they have made mistakes in the lane swaps in the last two games. They didn't bounce the wave in game one. Mm-hmm. And obviously last game was this crazy level one, level two thing.
Yep.
Where Martin then ends up TPing down with no flash and dying as well.
We're talking just the first 5 minutes of the game. Ku Tigers has been the better team.
Sadly, games are not only 5 minutes long.
I think that's something that SKT realizes well in advance as well. You see all these kills going to Ku around the map. SKT kind of has this database in their head. They say, you know, we could lose about 5 kills here, but if we get kills and a turret and dragon, we're right back in the game. And that's what they always set up for when they're down. They see what their opening is to get back in the game.
Well, SKT is actually doing about the same play they did earlier because they're sending an invade in to the double jungler. It's just on the different side of the map.
I don't know if they're going to be getting over walls on this one. They know what mistake they made last time. Now they're getting away with a bit more resources. No flashes being used there, but they do push Ku off that top side of the jungle.
So again, Ku Tigers, they keep starting in the jungle where the enemy AD carry and support is supposed to be, or at least on that side of the map. So they take away their own two camps on top side, which was supposed to belong to SKT, because SK Telecom always start in their own jungle. They start really defensively, so they don't deny anything. And now once again, there will be more camps to take for Ku Tigers down on the bottom side of the map. So SKT just instantly want to go up and start pushing down this tower, swap around, get this lane swap rolling, so you can't just fall further behind. They don't value getting early experience on Marin by taking multiple jungle camps. They just want you safe, and then push down the tower as fast as possible.
This top lane going a bit faster. It took Smeb some time to get down to that bottom tier turret, so SKT are going to be able to move a bit quicker here. Those few seconds to get to themselves, to back first, get in position, get their wards ready, and start being aggressive on the bottom side of the map is really what puts them ahead. Smeb being late here leaves still a third of this turret up.
Yeah, and they're going to teleport in and actually try and save this one. This will be a big question of how quickly Alistar gets down there. And Ku took enough damage from the minion wave that they can't actually threaten a dive. Also a weird move up top. Bank didn't bounce the wave in the top side.
See what Hojin does here, but the reason they didn't bounce the wave was because they realized they could TP down bottom lane. So they just wanted to push it out, get some farm going, and then force someone for Ku Tigers to recall and go up to top side and catch that wave so there's not going, these minions are going to waste. So because they saw how slow Ku Tigers were at the bottom side of the map, they felt like we can defend it. Bengi moved all the way down, TP in as well to stop it. Hojin should have been in a position, in my opinion, where he could either threaten them the 4v2 dive super quick, or just go down and realize we were behind him pushing the tower. I need to join in as well before this play even happened and just four-man kill this tower, because you never want to fall behind when it comes to fast pushing.
Well, they have all the pressure on the bot side. They have to watch for Prey to come up in the bottom side of the jungle here. Kuro in a bad spot. He walks right in with Faker on his tail. They're on Bengi, though. The flay back, very nice from Gorilla. Ignite and Flash used to make that happen. Faker now in a real sore spot. It looks like he'll be the next to go down. A bit of a fumble Ruski here coming in from SKT. And Ku are going to pick up some very nice kills all around the board. Three assists to Gorilla. It's working out perfectly. Distributing the kills. Nice. Bang trying to come in now. A huge, I think I can, situation from SKT to pick up the little outside experience that would ever happen.
They just got eight.
Four kills for Hojin in the early game. One goes to Prey.
One person and another person. And who wants to die next? And who wants to die next? SKT,
I knew.
Another early game fumble here against Ku, and they pick it up big. 4 kills onto Hojin. So what will he do now? Warrior Enchantment completed 5.5 minutes into the game.
I feel like we've seen this before in this series here. SKT makes a lot of mistakes and Hojin picks up all the kills.
Yeah, Gorilla's not actually level 1 in this fight. So the rest of this here, Hojin goes in big, level 3 Lee Sin spike. They kill Bengi right at the start. Faker was low on mana and actually had no business stopping that either. Prey, again, not level 1, is able to come in and finish those guys off. And why do Sivir and Rumble come up here when their entire team is already dead? Additionally, Fjord doesn't even have to be involved in this. This was 5 kills by 3 people on the Ku Tigers. This is, you know how we said in the first game, there's no way SKT falls as far behind early game as they did in game 2? There is a way. That's the way. 4 kills on a Hojin and a Warrior Enchantment already.
Not calculating the HP bars quite well in that situation. Possibly a bit of a play.
He's got no flash.
This could be the finalizer. Hojin holds the Resonating Strike to cancel out the rest of Faker.
And every time we have some of these extremely weird plays where there's no real reason for them to make it, we've got to look at what could be the objective. Why would SKT move in there in the first place? Well, in this case, it was to place a deep ward. And then they realized Gorilla face checks onto Bengi. They're like, oh, maybe we can take a fight here. You know, support just face check. We could get 1 kill. But they don't realize how Faker has no mana. They don't realize how everyone from Ku Tigers could move so quickly there. And really just such a sloppy decision.
And also, SKT didn't have the wave clear advantage. So this is exactly what Ku wants to do. They want to find fights in neutral territory when they don't lose objectives. SKT's way of stopping those things from happening is to keep the waves managed.
And this becomes extremely volatile for SKT now. Ku already set up to take down Faker behind a second tier turret, but they want to go to the bot lane, looking now at Bang and Wolf. Marin's going to clear top. Smeb's going to have to respect that and stay for the TP. It's down anyways, but we're going to see something happen in that bottom lane, possibly, as teams disperse a bit. It doesn't look like anything came out of it. Rightfully so, Ku would have had to make a pretty big dive.
Ku can just sit in the lanes and wait for Hojin to show up on his Lee Sin. Because he's so far ahead, he can take any fight he wants. Mm-hmm. And he can burst you down as soon as he hits level 6 and this Lee Sin. So wait for him to make that play. Because then you know there's no counter gank from Bengi available. He will be too far behind.
And these types of plays are the exact plays that Ku needs. They said they want the crowd to be chanting their name. And that's what they're getting right now. It'll lift the pressure off their shoulders. They know the crowd is behind them. But more so that their strats are working right now. We did see that Hojin was 2-0-2 on Rek'Sai in the early game in game 2. 5-0-1, hopefully he can continue to spread his experience to the rest of the lanes and keep this snowball going, because they did slow down after they got all those big plays in game 2.
And now it's also about slowing down the game if you were SKT. Mm-hmm. You know Lee Sin is going crazy. Faker also doesn't have that much lane pressure on Curl because he's been down his flash and also died twice. Plus, he doesn't have teleport, so it's kind of the worst situation you can be in as a mid laner. But SKT still has a lot of wave clear advantages, and they have a Rek'Sai who can give himself Tremor Sense in the jungle, line up to counter ganks, and more so than actually counter ganking, just tip someone off that they're coming so SKT can run away. They really just want to wave clear for a little while until Ku would make a mistake.
We do need to see Hojin, though, be a bit more aggressive now in this Lee Sin. You have so many kills, you need to almost live in the enemy jungle and say, I could take any fight possible against this Rek'Sai. Obviously, nothing completing for Bengi so far other than the Sidestone. SKT right now, though, have been able to push the top over and over and open up to just take the grapples.
And Hojin's going super aggressive. Not only did he complete his Warrior Enchantment 5 minutes in, he had enough gold for a Sidestone, but instead started building Hex Drinker components. Now he's got no wards left. One ward there, Trinket ward to jump out. He actually can't war jump to pull any type of trickery off.
Really would have liked to see Sidestone. I think
one
of the best ways to kind of snowball a jungle matchup is not necessarily by trying to kill the other jungler, but by getting wards in his jungle so you can spot him. Arrow onto Faker though. This is a play we're going to see quite often from Prey. He's very good at leaving his own lane in this Ashe here, moving towards mid or top lane, set up a possible pick. This time Hojin gets into the jungle though. This is what we like to see. I just wish he had some wards to be placing here as well now, so he can spot the Rek'Sai next time.
Relying a little too much on Lantern Escape.
I think Lee Sin's one of the best champions who can turn utility into offense. Sidestone increases the offensive capabilities of Lee Sin. Really disagree with this vibe from Hojin.
They've been loving their Hex Drinkers. Game after game, they continue to grab it.
Against the Rumble.
Faced up. Well, you're usually faced up against the double AP comp so far. We had the Kassadin Rumble, now Lulu Rumble. Once again, SKT definitely knows where to put that power once the mid game comes. This time, 2,000 gold lead to Ku, 6-1, full control of the game. Haven't really been able to keep their deep wards in the side of SKT, so that's slowing them down a little bit. But we know SKT,
the
Vision Denial Team, the flash play as soon as he gets it again. Hooks and Faker, the Dragon Kick back, and that's going to be a dead Faker once again. Nobody's in the back pocket to help him this time.
Faker tried to save his flash until all the CC were down first, but then obviously Lee Sin shows up with the Thresh here, kicks him back, and then it's too late for him to do anything. They keep trying to gank this mid lane. You know you have a Kassadin sitting there, and you just keep leaving this bottom side. Roam up through the river, go for the gank.
I think it's also critical that they were able to get the kill on a Kassadin here. So much of the kill distribution is on Hojin, which is why he needs to snowball the game right now, because otherwise,
yes,
his gold at the end of the game will not mean that much, and that's why SKT needs to stall this one out. So using the Lee Sin, Thresh, the power of the chain CC right there to punish Faker's greed of not using Flash was very well done.
Now, to question a bit of this, do they start spreading some love to Smeb in the top lane of the Fiora, or is he perfectly fine holding off Marin for as long as possible?
I mean, at the moment, if you want to gank Marin, you should realize Bengi will be nearby, because every time Marin pushes up, Bengi shows himself, gets a ward in the jungle, and she's kind of there for safety. So they're just going to say, no, we can just keep camping this mid lane. We have double CC, we have the Astral and the Arrow in case we need that one as well. But yes, they could definitely also go and gank Marin. It's just easier to rotate from bottom lane with your support straight to mid lane. That's a quick one, easy gank to set up.
It's so hard for Ku to create picks though, because they're still running without a Sightstone on their whole team.
He didn't even buy a ward when he went
Gorilla
back.
Didn't buy Sightstone, he built Boots of Mobility. So they're trying to go in blind and make plays with superior combat stats right now. It is absurdly aggressive and incredibly unreliable, but Ku is going all out right here, trying to pull this off. Big change of strategy from Ku Tigers in this game than in prior.
It's very clear in the pick and ban phase. Coming into this game, Ku Tigers said, okay, it's all or nothing. Just pick some champions where we can pick them off, skirmish really well, and go crazy. I feel like in the game though, once you get the 5 kills early on, you can then adapt that and say, okay, we don't have to go all in crazy now. Because we just got 5 kills. We can play it out normal and just have a big advantage.
Get the 5 kills, place the wards, and make it easier to pick with all of your pick abilities. Instead of Ku, what they're trying to do is run through SKT, force, run into someone randomly, and get the kill.
Well,
but
they have
brute force.
They have blips of vision, right? A Hawk Shot will go out here, a Hawk Shot will go out there. They'll have somewhat vision, and they'll work off of that bit. But you're right. They don't know who's around the corner after Hawk Shot's gone.
That's why coaches really want to be able to talk in-game. I see the arrow misses, but Nofa's been like, guys, go crazy, man. Go all in. We're going to do this. And then when all this happens, he just want to stand back and be like, okay, slow down. All right, get vision, then we play it out.
No way to tell them to slow down right now.
Nope.
And the wave clear will be punished eventually. They're continuing to keep the pressure on mid lane. And because they are so strong right now with straight up item advantages, Hexdrinker completed, Tiamat completed, they haven't been punished yet for this craziness that they're doing.
Definitely employing a new strat for this one. Wolf finds he's in a bad situation in the box. Do they have enough to get to Gorilla? Smeb actually teleports down here, but it's called in as well. From the other teleports onto Bangi now. Looks like they should be able to get out. Bang does not want the grand challenge. Wolf goes down immediately. Marin able to teleport, but he wasn't close to the fight. Kuro should go down here. Seed over to him. A lantern as well. Light still ticks through. The flash was burned from Kuro quite a bit as well. This could give SKT a little bit of love around that dragon area to get more wards and keep fighting. Wow, Smeb wants to go in. They know Gorilla's there, but very low on mana here. Smeb, Hojin looking to build a little bit of energy as well. I don't think it's a fight either side wants to take, but they were still trying to blow summoners on both sides. Successful at that.
That's a 1-for-1 against a team who had 7 kills already at 14 minutes against one only from SKT. Them trading even would always be in their favor because you're so far behind. It's never in the favor of Ku Tigers to just trade even. Hojin even took the kill. Alistar was like 100% dead. Kicks him in the face and kills him.
Hojin's going one direction right now. Lee Sin care. That's all he's thinking
it
right
was
now.
Enough
he's
to
trying to put
though.
The team on his back. And this is also the mentality you put yourself in when you are down 2-0 in a series, because you are always trying to make that big play. But so far, it's been mostly working for Ku.
Oh, arrow to the knee on Wolf. I don't know if he's going to be out of this one. He gets the headbutt in. It's good that he kind of just let it happen. You didn't want to try to use too much to get away. He actually did flash in the end, thinking he could break the brush vision, but it did not work. The coup chance come out once again, and they will again deny the resources in the jungle of SKT.
Yeah, now you have that side stone, two wards instantly placed in the jungle. You get a pick. Wolf was way out of position trying to place a deep ward himself, but with zero backup from his laners. A mistake we have seen from SKT, honestly, today a few times, where one guy just goes in on his own to place a ward, then gets caught out. Yep. This is what Koo Tiger's composition wants to do. Oh, are you alone? You're running way too far ahead of your own team? We have all the tools to CC you and chase you. There's going to be a cast in the late game, constantly jumping after you as well.
And what Koo is pulling off right now is what so many teams unsuccessfully do against well-executed wave clear compositions. Because in order to stop the side lanes from pushing out of control for SKT, you have to kill them before they get up to your turret. And Koo has been able to find fights and consistently kill, which is why it's just the one turret taken down for SKT versus the two from Koo. And now that they actually do have the double sight stones built up, they can continue to put on the pressure and the vision.
Double sight stones means they all swapped over to sweepers. A very early scrying orb still from Prey to go along with his hawk shots have given Koo great vision in this early part of the game to waltz into the jungle of SKT. Pretty much without any care. Now they have the wards so deep, a pink ward all the way down between the second tier turrets. They have all the vision they need here to make those pick moves they've been wanting to make all game.
The only thing SKT is going for them is the fact that Marin, they go hit level 11 soon, which is good spikes for them when it comes to a possible dragon fight. This is what Koo Tigers want.
Trying to stop SKT
in their perfect run.
From having a perfect run at Worlds, but would be the first in the history of the World Championship.
And SKT has been positive. They said, if this team doesn't beat us, we're more than likely going to go undefeated in the entire tournament. We feel better about it every win.
Here they come.
This is the crowd control they were looking for. There's no way Bengi gets out of this one. He goes down with the last shot from Prey. 2-0-5 now for the AD carry.
And this is what we're going to keep seeing here. Wards being placed. Bengi can no longer sit and farm his own jungle. If he ever does so, expect Koo Tigers to show up, catch him out like they just did right here, get that one kill. Problem is, they give up a bot lane tower and only get a kill for it. So technically, for them, not the greatest trade, but it did mean Marin also had to be careful top, so now they can trade for top tower.
It's a delayed trade. It's still favorable for the Koo Tigers because they got the map pressure. Kill Squad, Hojin and Gorilla, they have been successfully creating these picks. 100% kill participation for Hojin, 90% kill participation for Gorilla, and it's allowed Smeb to not have to carry. So much of this entire world and of the first two games have been Smeb carrying, and he was pushing too hard in the first few games. Now the weight is being taken off of Smeb's shoulders in this game, and it's actually been Hojin.
I was just going to say that one of the biggest changes from both of the games we've seen is that Koo is not focusing top. They're not trying to get things for Smeb. They're not trying to stop Marin. They've stayed away from that, and it's working perfectly for them because SKT turns those fights around. Looking at 20 minutes coming up on the clock now, 10-2, the biggest lead Koo has had here in these games, as well as a 5,000 gold lead coming up on that 20-minute mark.
And Dragon coming up in 12 seconds, it's what a pick composition lives for. Not necessarily doing the Dragon, but killing someone when they're trying to get vision or contest the Dragon.
It's dinner time.
Fortunately for SKT though, they've been able to get a lot of wards preemptively around the Dragon Pit since Koo just committed so many people to killing the other side of the map. So the picks will be harder to come by.
Every time Koo has killed them, one other guy snuck in behind them and placed two or three wards in the river, and then they had to escape. But they always gave up a kill for it, so Koo Tigers kept getting further and further ahead in terms of gold. We're still only 19 minutes into the game. There's plenty of time for the Koo Tigers to use all this gold here to their advantage. For now, they're gonna have to fight for vision, and SKT gets at least an entrance.
And I have to reiterate how difficult it is to beat SKT, because they've been able to get those wards here. And they actually have a power spike here, with Marin being level 11 on Rumble. A well-placed equalizer at this dragon fight, even with the 5,000 gold difference, could win a fight for SKT.
One of the problems though for Marin, and that's also why he's down on the bottom side here, is if he goes top now to catch this wave, which he probably will to defend the tower, when you're against Kassadin, Ashe, and so on, they can hard engage in and pick off one target. Your teleport becomes very difficult to use because obviously there's this delay on the teleport casting before you arrive. Koo Tigers might have picked off a guy before Marin even gets to TP in. So him sitting there, means Koo Tigers can be the proactive team now. Look for that one arrow here. Look for Kuro to catch out a guy. A lot of damage on Gorilla, though.
If they start the dragon, that's going to mean even more damage. They don't necessarily have someone who can tank the dragon without taking any pain. Maybe this turns into a steal opportunity because Bengi would be able to tunnel in and try and get something. Koo is forcing really hard to try and get a fight.
Koo Tiger's chance resonating through the halls of the Mercedes-Benz Arena here in Berlin. Hojin takes the dragon. Smeb TP's into the backside. They're still getting out. This is where the picks come in. Wild growth onto Bengi. The focus is Marn. He's away from the team. Smeb wants to keep everybody in range, but he's gone on a one-man mission over here. Bengi gets out. Smeb lunges back. Gorilla is a one health from being taken down right now, and Koo doesn't get enough of the picks that they want, but Marin does go down from being in the thick of the fight.
Wow, and how close this fight really was. It is an advantage for Koo to get the dragon and the kill.
Absolutely.
But if we're thinking about total damage dealt in that team fight, SKT actually did more. Pretty much everyone on Koo took 80% or more of their health bar. They can absolutely bring the pain, especially if SKT funnels in like that chasing kills.
Say it again.
You can see how SKT knows they don't want to risk someone going down before Marin arrives. So he goes in fairly early with teleport and beautiful ulti.
Yeah, that was
three
huge
guys from the Koo Tigers. This delays everything. They're trying to chase, but they're so split up now. Smeb doesn't even get Bengi down, but in the end, they win the fight.
Woo!
They get this dragon here like they're supposed to. Bang was very, very close to suddenly being able to get a few kills.
Absolutely. Bang maybe could have played that a little more aggressive, but still, when you're down 11 kills to 2, your aggressive moves have been biting you time and time again. And Koo is really looking to take this series back.
Gorilla surviving that fight with 6 HP, some thick skin there to keep him alive. Ignite still up, kill pressure from him to come into the next fight if necessary. And this may be that time again. Koo starts to taunt Baron, but more of a trial and error here. See how SKT reacts and then act on that.
It's the time for Koo Tigers to start getting the pink wards. Upgrade your sweepers
yes
here, both on Gorilla and Hojin, because you need to be able to deny vision at the dragon, at the Baron. Force SKT to face check in, and then again, create this pick where you just shoot an arrow in their face. SKT have all five members nearby. Koro taking a bit of damage, but you can see how they're fighting, because SKT knows if they give up that jungle,
yeah,
it's over. Because then the Baron will be started,
they're
completely blind, and then they will die in the next team fight. So that's why they're here so early, to fight just for vision. There's always these pre-fights before the big team fight where you fight all the small advantages. Who can see who? Can they start the Baron safely? There's no tank
no
in the lineup of Koo Tigers. That makes it tricky, and that's
why
they need
game
a kill first.
A little game of cat and mouse here. Are you going to approach? How do you approach? Can we cut you off? Can we get that pick when you're rotating towards the Baron? Koo have a lot of room to work with right here, outside the vision of SKT.
Marin should not be on the bottom side of the map at the moment. He has no TP. This
yeah
just gave Koo Tigers the jungle, and they're pushing in for top tower.
Yeah, because now SKT can't actually hold this turret with wave clear in fear of a dive.
The wave going through, the crowd has been cheering for Koo, and it looks like the arrow hits Bang. The spell shield was on, he does not get crowd controlled. That's the grand challenge on Bangy. Thrust, thrust, parry, and he gets the kill. 13-2 as they start cleaning up SKT without losing any members on the side of Koo.
Koo Tigers has successfully put an element of chaos into this game, which is making SKT make bad decisions. That was a bad decision. Marin wasn't able to defend. The dive is very real with an Ash Arrow initiate plus a Lee Sin with Flash, and they are rightfully punished for that move. And now with two death timers looming, the Baron becomes another problem.
Crowd started chance. People standing up and creating these chants for Koo. It's exactly
all
what
Koo wants to do is fall.
Down to Marin, but it's Kuro and Marin now. Marin knows he's not going to get out of this one safely. Slowed once again. I don't believe the volley just yet, but they're going to be in range. Who are they going to give it to? Merry Christmas, an early Christmas to Prey.
SKT managed to stop the Baron, but that was about it. Three kills again for Koo Tigers. Summoner spells used. This is looking so, so bad, and really this game exploded.
I'd say it's looking good for Koo.
It looked great for Koo, obviously. Bad for SKT, but really, we had the five kills early on, and then Koo Tigers got a few kills here and there.
See what happened
it
here
really
one more time
exploded when it started getting to that jungle, get down the vision, and been able to create these picks here. Faker, even
oh
Faker,
God
can flash into the wall.
When you have Faker failing a flash over wall, you know something is amiss within the SKT team. They've been making bad calls.
Mm-hmm.
Faker, I can't remember the last time I've seen him miss a flash.
just reminds us that he's human.
And if there's ever a time for SKT to drop a game, guys, it's now. 8,000 gold down, Ku continually finding team fights again and again. And I'm going to have to question, if Ku's able to win this game, do they actually completely turn the momentum of the series? Because remember, they were winning, they were in a position to win game two.
Yes, but then we saw some of the problems for them late game with the shot calling.
Right.
This game, that should not be an issue when you're so far ahead now. Your composition, at this point, is going to be straightforward to play because you just keep baiting around the Baron and then you just fire that arrow from Prey and you take that team fight. It is hard to get to this point for Ku Tigers. Due to the fact that they got so many early kills, it made it a lot easier for them. They've been able to execute it properly now, and we're just waiting for that finish. Because right now, SK is hurt. They're not dead yet.
They're not dead yet, but this is finally Ku breaking through that mental barrier that SKT puts up. We saw Faker go down twice to Westdoor alone in lane, and Faker was almost smiling, laughing, knowing that they would come back because they have the confidence. Here, that seems to be broken. SKT always turning tail to these fights to see if they can assess and go back in, but it has been for naught.
Yeah, and actually SKT going for a big fight in the mid lane.
Arrow straight to the face of Bang, stops Gorilla from going down. Initiations on both sides of On the Hunt. Crystalline Arrow and Box are down.
And something we actually have to talk about, SKT ran Lulu Sivir frequently throughout the regular season, and they use as a mid-game power-spiking team that got picks. But when it falls behind, it is really difficult for it to come back since it has to move as a unit.
Now that Sivir ulti is gone, it could have opened up for Ku Tigers to maybe make a play on the bottom side against Marin, send down Hoji and his 2v1 dive him. Instead, they're returning to the Baron. Back the way from the bottom lane here with Smep.
Ku has not hesitated on any of their calls this game. That's a risky call, though, because they are on a scrying orb. And now the teleport's coming in.
Marin down. Their target is actually to stop Ku, and they're flanked back. We see Faker and Wolf messing with Meb down here, but it is not working out for them. Lunging over the wall, Ku is instantly back in position. This should not hurt them too much. A lot of ultimates are already being used by SKT. Remember, Wolf's ult is down from that second tier turret in mid, so they can't afford to go back in.
Remember that this team does not have a tank who's going to stack armor that can safely stand in front of this Baron here. It was Kassadin and so on, trying to bounce it with Hojin. Both of them took a lot of damage, and you're against the Rumble. You never want to start a fight low against the Rumble because that's just going to be terrible for you. Here's a fight.
It's a bit of a flank here. Prey very low on mana, but you don't need that to auto attack. That's going to be Wolf down. We also lost Meb in the fight. Marin holding tight in the middle. They get the turret, so they'll be able to fight under it now. Hojin doing what he can with such an awesome score in this game, and it looks like it's going to be a lot for the team. That's a double. Faker gets hit by the arrow. That's going to be a kill for Prey as well. Is there a triple coming in here? No, it's a double-double for Kuro and Prey.
Another
SKT
team fight win there by the Ku Tigers. And honestly, if there was ever a fight that SKT is going to win there, it would have been that one. Ku was so low on resources beforehand, but SKT had such a gargantuan gold deficit, and Hojin is playing out of his mind on Lee Sin with a beautiful kick on to Bang back into the team. This gives him Baron too.
Wow.
Hojin is a jungler that's been criticized for a very poor early game coming into this final. All three games now, he's had a very, very good early game. He's picking up early kills, early assists. He's applying a lot of pressure on the map. Obviously, there's a few things maybe he can still change, but after all, he's playing a lot better now in that early game. You see the fight, Smep goes down very early, but this kick from Hojin is massive.
One, two, three.
Tower is still alive as well, and it's just straight into Koro. He gets that kill, and now they can start chasing.
And Hojin also landed the Sonic Wave the instant Marin came out of Zhonya's. Then they clear his corpse out of the way, land the Ash Arrow onto Faker, and chase down the rest of it. They are really in sync right now, which is something that was distinctly lacking in games 1 and 2.
So he changes his name back to Lee after this one. What plays coming in from Hojin. Last game he was 2-0-2, and he kind of divvied up the kills after that a little bit more. Now he's 6-0-14. It seems like getting more of that experience, more of that cash on Hojin, it definitely pays off for the team. Another game where Prey has come up big as well in the Ash, the initiation that Ku loves so much.
Oh, no.
It's actually being turned right back onto him. It is the Dark Passage that tries to bring Prey to the light, but it cannot happen. The box goes down, but everybody runs around, and it looks like they mitigate that slow. A kill onto Gorilla, and now SKT make a bit of their own pick comp with a first headbutt going on to Prey.
Look at the minimap right now. Koro was sitting in the top lane. No teleport, obviously, on the Kassadin. And then Ku Tigers to start pushing down to the tier 2 tower. Only 3 members against a severe composition.
Yep.
These are the kind of mistakes they've made in the other games, where even though they had a lead, it never felt like the game was over.
Against SKT, the game is never over. No matter how big the lead
so
is,
true.
We have seen it time and time again, and that was an example of the Sivir pick composition. Why is Hojin also trying to defend this turret solo?
So he can get a 4-man kick.
Bang wants to go a little too deep, gets hit by the turret. Oh, Faker over the wall! A shutdown, that's huge gold for Faker coming in from Hojin. That'll definitely be an item coming online for him. Hits Arrow, but Arrow's not going to stop this one. Kuro goes down as everybody inside the base does what they can with the globals they have. Smeb still putting pressure on the bottom. If Marn had been there, that would have been detrimental for Ku.
Well, they already got all the kills, and all they had to do was defend the bottom side. Smeb got one tower, but SKT suddenly picking up, I believe, 5 kills. 2 kills first in the mid lane, or 4 kills in total here. For SKT, and that is massive when you're so far behind.
Especially because both Kuro and Hojin had maximum bounties, which means 500 gold for the kill and 300 gold for the assist. 800 total gold for the team amongst both of those.
Let's see what happened here. Thought Bang went a little too close, but they knew what they were doing.
Yeah, at this point I was expecting Kuro to just jump back into his base because he would have been safe. But with the Ash Arrow coming in, I think Kuro was thinking he could convert a kill. Faker saved his ultimate for just the right time, saves Bang. It's such a close fashion.
Wolf takes the arrow, is tanking the turret. Nothing could have gone better there unless they aced the team. And those were members of Ku with Baron. Now, not having it, it's going to be much harder for them to get these waves in. Still onto Smeb, and try to still work that side lane.
It's time to relax a little bit if you're the Ku Tigers. In your communication, you're probably still screaming. You're super hyped. You're about to win this game. Everything has been working for you. Now is where you calm down, your shot caller kind of tells the rest of the team, okay, what's our next objective? Tier 2 tower in mid lane, how are we going to get it? Well, we can no longer split up because we know Sivir can hard engage, and there's enough damage on the side of SKT to kill us then. So put the Kassadin with us, slow push the other lane to see top lane was pushing down. They have to go back now and re-push that lane and then move the Kassadin back into this mid lane so you avoid being caught out by Sivir. And when the next fight happens, you're all 5 members there together, and you can use your composition.
And with the amount of gold he has, Hojin making a pretty selfish choice in the Banshee's Veil against this double AP team. Still no Aegis on the side of Ku, which could come back to bite him.
Yeah, I think the way Ku is approaching this game mentally is skirmish, skirmish, skirmish.
Skirmish, yeah.
And if they're trapped in a big team fight where they're sitting on an equalizer, they're probably thinking they've lost anyway. I still would like to see the Aegis in there for Hojin, but with the Banshee's Veil, when he jumps in and kicks someone backwards, it's much harder for them to get him out of there. Wolf can't headbutt him with first spell, Faker can't polymorph him, they have to burn 2 spells in order to stop him from doing that. So it's actually kind of an offensive pickup as well.
It's still so greedy though, because Banshees is one of these items that look good on paper and
it's
then one ability to hit you before the fight starts and it does really nothing for him. Lockett would have been way better for the rest of his team, but Hojin, he's been on a mission to carry this game.
It is the pattern of the game.
It
that's
is.
Exactly
Definitely.
What he's been doing. Hex Drinker over Sightstone, Warrior Enchantment
in 5
minutes.
Oh yeah, that's true. Good call in the beginning
there. It's a one-track mind here for Ku Tigers. They're going all in on this specific playstyle, and it is leaking into every single facet of their game.
You got a pocket full of money. Impulse buys happen more than not, and looks like Hojin has been grabbing everything up for himself here. Still looking at a 10,000 gold lead, and
Beautiful. Possibly
a Bengi going down. Knocks him out of the tunnel. Arrow hits Wolf once again. Unbreakable Will completely stops the crowd control, and that was worked perfectly with the tanks on the front line for SKT. They have a chance to go back in. Kuro finds himself in a real bad spot, and Smeb is kept at bay. Why are they still going in? Prey was on the front line there. They're going to have Gorilla here. He tries to bob and weave, slalom the minions to slow down SKT, but they're giving back the game inch by inch here.
I was just about to praise Ku Tigers for having that slow push on top side and have the Kassadin sit ready in the mid lane to create a pick, but then it dive on the tower with Kuro tanking the tower as well.
And we're 34 minutes in, so this could actually mean the inhibitor going down.
Crazy.
If you are Ku right now, who does SKT remind you of right now? A team down, holding out with some nice team fighting.
I was gonna say Bob Ross.
It feels like the Ku Tigers.
This game is ruined.
Oh, Smeb!
Oh, Smeb! Bringing out the blaze. He had a bit more to offer. He is just tanking the turret with happiness, a smile on his face. A few more hits. Smeb coming up with a 2v1 very nicely. And this is where SKT has to turn
back alive.
They are back. They are on Wolf. That's That's the not Unbreakable Will. That's a Wild Growth coming out. Unbreakable Will is up, but I don't even know if he uses it to try and get out here. They're going to try to walk Ku around as much as possible. Face of the Mountain is all he's got to offer there as he holds the ult for the possibility of a very big fight in their base coming up.
So Smeb has been farming for the last 35 minutes. I think we've barely seen him in this game. He's just been sitting in that side.
It's worked so well for Ku.
And now, finally, he gets his chance. One versus two, kills them. That was so huge, because SKT were pushing in the base. They were gonna get Inhibitor, get more kills, get back in the game, and then the outplay happens.
After such a turning moment, this is what Ku Tigers talk about when they talk about their team chemistry, honestly, because how many teams at Worlds this year have we seen go down 2-0 and been able to bounce back in the third game? Absolutely
nope.
And then after making multiple mistakes in the third game, be able to still go for the play and have it work. They have the trust in each other, and they've said even when they make a bad play, they can move on from it. That is a perfect example of it working in the game. But still, they're yet to close, and they still haven't taken a single game off SKT.
And I'm 100% sure SKT after this game, if they do end up losing it, they're gonna sit down and talk about the first 5 minutes of these games.
Of all games,
every
single absolutely.
One, there have been some crazy aggressive plays from SKT where they get punished, plays they didn't have to make in the first place. Why set yourself behind, or why risk setting yourself behind when you've shown that shock holding wise, late game, you are the better team? That is something they're gonna have to change for next game if they lose this one.
Think of what would happen, though, if those plays had worked. Your mentality to be crushed that hard in the first 5 minutes of the game. Luckily for Ku, it hasn't for SKT, and they have been falling behind, which is really giving them a chance to be in this game. And they're not even on a thread right now. They are in the lead, pretty much just walking down the road.
It's been plays that you couldn't win. Flashing forward on the tower to get a first spot is just you trading a kill for kill, but using your flash.
Yeah.
So like, you are basically lost no matter what you do.
You talk about trying to be calm as well on a stage like this, World Finals, even though SKT has been there before. It's Marin's first Worlds as well.
That's
there
true.
Is a moment of the spectacle. Here we go,
A hit on the Faker. Eyes focused onto him. He's forced to flash over the wall, but it doesn't save him. Curl gets the shot necessary. A double kill for the Kassadin, and this spells very bad things for SKT. The bottom inhibitor is already broken, feeding super minions into the base. This is going to be Marin going down as well, as he's too far from home. Over the wall, Bang's going to go down now. The fly in, the lunge from Smeb, a few more hits. The parry is great, the thrust is better, and he goes down. Huge kills for Kuro. They're on the Nexus turret, and it looks like they could thwart the perfect record of SKT at Worlds. The first Nexus turret to go down, the ace of SKT in their own base, and the Ku Tigers will break the perfect record at Worlds for SKT. We're going to a game four.
Ku Tigers decided to all in on this game here. All the way back in Champ Select, we talked about how risky the comp was, but if it starts to get rolling, how powerful it can be.
And for the first time at Worlds, SKT is wounded. Ku Tigers get what they want here. The crowd was chanting Ku Tigers at multiple moments during that last game. And here, once again, there is the crowd behind them.
Absolutely amazing. Nobody thought it could be done.